and afraid to do.
This morning, I thank you for your healing me, but Lord, I just thank you so much that I hope this song ministered to those that heard it from the heart. Lord, I just lift up Todd to you this morning. I just thank you for bringing us back home to us. Amen. Lord, I just thank you so much. I want to introduce my little brother here, Todd Markham.
Thank you, ladies. Can y'all hear me, test? Guys, I feel like that I'm over there at Tulsa at that rodeo fixing to nod my head for $1 million. I'm a little bit nervous, but I'm more excited to share with y'all what God's done in my life. I don't take this lightly. I'd like to say good morning and welcome to Cowboy Junction. Thank you for coming today. It's a privilege to give my testimony and share what God has done in my life. Guys, he's transformed my life. I don't claim to be perfect up here and act like I don't have no sin or I'm Wade Markham or Dennis or Jess, because I'm far from those men. But I am thankful by the grace of God. I'm not the same man I was many years ago when y'all knew me, when Paul and we was playing softball. I'm not that same person. And I praise God for that. Guys, the foundation of my testimony is the cross, is what Jesus did on the cross, the death, burial, and resurrection. That's what Jesus Christ has done. I want to turn to Ezekiel 36:25-27. And I am getting older. I have to use these cheaters. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. Your filth will be washed away, and you will no longer worship idols. Guys, at one time I had a lot of idols. Rodeo, roping, gambling, you name it. I had a lot of idols, but praise God. We keep on reading. Verse 26. And I will give you a new heart with a new and right desires. I will put a new spirit in you. I will take out your stony heart of sin and give you a new obedient heart. And I will put my spirit in you so you obey my laws and do whatever I command. That's my foundational scripture for my testimony, folks. A lifestyle of sin causes us to have a stony heart that leads us down a path of self-destruction. John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but God comes to give us life more abundantly. You know, for many years, the devil was having a heyday, and my life was destroyed. But today, I'm living an abundant life. And have y'all ever heard the saying that sin will take you farther than you want to go, or keep you longer than you want to stay, cost you more than you want to pay? Folks, my sin, my addiction to methamphetamine cost me everything. It cost me my freedom. It cost me to raise my two boys. It cost me a good, successful marriage, my relationships with my family and friends. That's what drugs did to my life. But praise God, my story didn't end in death. God has brought restoration. He's given me new desires, and He's changed my heart, because I used to have a stony heart, folks. But Jesus Christ, He is my Redeemer. Like many of you, my childhood was great. I was raised in this brick home right across the street here. My parents are Wade and Louise Markham. They're the founders of here at Cowboy Junction. And I want to say hi to them. They can't be here this morning. They're over there listening on Facebook. So hi, Mom and Dad. My brothers and sisters was good. Although my brother, he was a state champion wrestler. And whenever I was little, because I was so honored, he'd put me in a guillotine, put me on the back. But he's a lot older than I am now, so I think I could take him. My sister, she's always been a blessing to me. I mean, been there through this whole deal. I can't tell you all the things she's done for me. But it ain't about my family. It's about what God's done in my life and my family. Me and Kevin went to Vacation Bible School at an early age, and I was saved over at Vacation Bible School. I got Kevin in trouble at Vacation Bible School one time. I can't remember all the details, but heck, we was little and I was getting in trouble back then at Vacation Bible School. Guys, I have a lot of good memories of my childhood. You'd think, you'd wonder how in the world would I fall for the trap. It can happen to anybody, because I did fall for a trap. I remember playing Little League baseball, like with Chris and many of y'all in here. We had some winning teams. My dad was the coach. And we had some good times. My childhood was perfect. Guys, I started roping at the age of 13, and I was pretty good with a rope. I wasn't the best, but God gave me that talent. I was a senior in high school, folks, and I won the CAA championship that year, a senior in high school. I'd made the IFR that year, or roped at the IFR, roped at the ACRA finals, had won buckles, saddles, you name it. It looked like I was probably headed to the NFR at a very early age. But you know what? I know many of y'all traveling and you rodeo people, y'all see a lot of detours on the road. You can't hardly drive to Tulsa without getting on a detour. Well, guys, at Kobe, Kansas, I took a life detour. I took my first drug up there, and it kept me on a detour for many, many years. I struggled with my addiction for over 10 years. Sure, some good things happened during this time. I got married to Michelle. She's the best thing that's ever happened to me, probably. Probably. My two boys, some days. Guys, I won a lot of rodeos and had a lot of good times. But my life was up one day and down the other. Mostly, during this time period, the devil had a heyday in my life. And I'm not going to stand up here and give glory to the devil. The bottom line is, folks, and I'll claim it, I take full responsibility for it. I was a terrible person. I did have that stony heart that we'd read about. I was a bad husband. I was the worst of the worst. I was a complete failure. That was many years ago. I had no boundaries. Guys, when I was using drugs, many of y'all know this, I had no boundaries. I had a gambling addiction. When I was at the casino, I promise you, I max bet it. That's the way my lifestyle was. I lived life in the fast lane. I was a total mess. Guys, at 29 years old, I was up at Springfield, Missouri, and committed some terrible things. But you know what? God got me out of that, and I got a slap on the wrist. But that didn't change me. For the next few years, I just kept doing the same thing, and I never changed my life. How many know God will not be mocked? Guys, I was at the end of my rope, and I was over there. I was in my early 30s. I was over at Joe Blevins' house. I was going to do a good deed that day. And I come to that stop sign. It was like we used to have the cowboy logo, man. I was like a cowboy at a crossroads in my life. And I chose myself. If I had not chosen God that day, I don't think I would, I don't know what would have happened. But I chose myself and ended up going to Miami, Oklahoma that day and done some serious things over there. Shot a firearm and ended up with a 15-year federal prison sentence. I'm not going to go into great detail with that. God used that prison experience in my life. I'm going to own it and take responsibility. God, the drugs didn't make me do it. I take responsibility for doing what I did. Prison saved my life. I know we have many people in here that train horses, and y'all use a round pen to get the horse's attention and do whatever. Well, guys, I feel like God used that round pen of the federal prison system, so to speak, in my life. He allowed that. And because prison is a hostile environment, but God protected me through it all. I mean, I was in the medical line. I hurt my leg playing softball one time up there, and I seen a guy took a lock, and this man lost his life. He was just a few people in front of me. I played softball in prison. You know, God, I mean, it was... We used to play in the church league here, and you know how serious it can be. So you can just imagine how serious it was in prison. I learned to throw a pretty good strike because they would make fun of you. Guys, I want to tell you about my first job in prison. This is where my first test was. My family don't even know about this. My family was up at Bon Terre, Missouri, visiting me in prison. And when they left, that sergeant asked me, he said, "Do you want a job?" And I said, "Yes, sir." I didn't know this at the time. This was early in my bit, how sought out a position this was. He put me in charge of cleaning the visiting room and what have you. Well, when I got back to my room that day, I was approached by a couple of men that asked me, or pretty much told me, that you're going to bring drugs back in this institution. You're going to bring it back from the women's bathroom. Guys, God gave me a boldness that day. I don't know where it come from, but I looked those men right in the eye, and I said, "I'm not going to do that. I'm trying to do everything I can to get back to my family." And guys, that simple obedience that day, they didn't like it, but they respected it. For 5 years, I was up there at Bon Terre, and I had favor in that visiting room, folks. God blessed me right there in that prison. When you're in prison, one of the most important things you can do is have a visit. And because God placed me in that visiting room, when my family would come, I promise you, I learned to run a buffer pretty good, so I had it like the red carpet rolled out when my family come. We had the best table. We had, when Sandy or whoever would come over and we'd bring a food visit, my sister or whoever was there, we had the best table by the microwave. I had a new deck of cards. That might not seem like a whole lot, but in prison, it's everything, because that's what's important to you. Guys, prison was a very humbling experience for me. Y'all watch TV and what have you, but for me, it was a very humbling experience, and God got me through some rough times. I remember one time up there, we had a revival. Some church group come up there from St. Louis, and we had a three-day revival, and at the end of that three-day revival, we had a foot washing. I could just imagine when Jesus washed those people's feet, you know, how humbling an experience that must have been for them. Can you imagine being in a room with 60 or 80 fellow convicts and washing each other's feet? I didn't mind washing the guy's foot that I was doing, but it was so humbling for him to do mine. I mean, it was a very humbling experience, and God touched my life. I can remember the church services up in prison. Man, there was 60, 80, 100 people at times. I was in a maximum security prison. Guys, there was people up there that had life sentences. A good, real good friend of mine, he's never going home. I would trust him with everything. It's just some people make mistakes and they go to prison. They don't define who you are. But I remember these men being up there in the prison at the worship service. Such a powerful thing. I've seen healings. God is not limited. He will go inside a prison. I've seen it firsthand. I've experienced. I remember these 60 or 80 men many times would be raising their hands just crying out to God. And sometimes in here, I feel like when Mandy and Kathy and their anointed music, it's okay to stand to your feet and clap your hands. It ain't going to offend them. It ain't going to offend nobody. It's okay to give glory and praise to our Lord and Savior. I mean, He's the King of Kings. You can praise Him for what He's done, but praise Him for who He is. I think it would be a good deal. That's just my opinion. Guys, I remember being in a prison cell early on in my bit. For some reason, I was in solitary confinement. We was on lockdown or whatever it was. It was late in the night. I was crying out to God. I was missing my family. It ain't easy being in prison. I mean, the hard part's being away from your family, but God was with me. And I'm telling you, I was inside a prison and within a prison. But the Spirit of God came in that place that day, and I was in there singing and shouting my little victory in Jesus and having a real encounter with God. I feel like if they would have been singing there, maybe the prison walls would even fell down. I mean, it was that powerful. It changed my life, and I've not been the same. That's well over 10 years ago. Guys, a lot of people go to prison, and they become better criminals. They learn how to cook dope. They learn how to rob a bank. It's a shame. And there's just as many drugs in prison as there is on the streets. It just costs a lot more. It's sad because that's what put me there. But what I did in prison, by the grace of God, I took advantage of my time and didn't become a better criminal. I took classes like anger management, effective communication. I remember one class I took was the Toastmasters. I don't know if y'all know what that Toastmaster is. Cindy Green used to. She was a big believer in Toastmasters. She's no longer with us. She was a blessing in my life and encouraged me during those times. But I was giving a speech that day. You know, I'm from Oklahoma. I was in federal prison with people from all over the world. And they railroaded me with my Okie language. One speech I was saying, I was going to go feed the horses. Well, I learned quickly that gonna is not a real word. I told them in Oklahoma it is. Guys, the last 5 years of my prison sentence, I was in the dog program. Such a blessing. God allowed me to be in this dog program, and I got my apprenticeship through the U.S. Department of Labor. But what really ministered to me and touched my heart is one day we got a letter back, and one of my dogs had got placed with this military vet. And my hat's off to military people if you're in here today, because this guy here had PTSD. And he is more in prison than I was in prison, folks. But God blessed me with a gift and the opportunity to train this dog. And my dog got placed, this guy, we got this letter back. And he was in his house, had been, never left his house for 4 years because of this disease. And he was thanking us and thanking God that he had finally went to the grocery store for the first time. That's the kind of favor that I had in prison and God allowed me to be part of. So prison actually saved my life. I'm going to own it. You know, I'm not proud of it, but God, I walked through the storm, and it wasn't fun at times, but God has used that situation to change my life. Guys, it was tough some days, but you know what got me through some tough days that really ministered to me? There's many of you in here, and I'm looking at many of you. I would get letters from y'all, and it's in the Bible somewhere about writing people in prison or remembering people in prison. But I'm telling you all, I would be depressed or having a tough day, and I would get mail call. I remember one day on my birthday, I got like 50 birthday cards. The whole mail room, I mean, all them guys that's lined up for mail call, 4 o'clock mail call, and every piece of mail was for Todd Markham. That blesses you. That shows people, showed me that people back home still cared. And you'll still care, or you wouldn't be here today, because it was public that I was going to be speaking. I was afraid nobody might not show up. And that would have been okay, because I did come over here and practice, and there wasn't nobody in the audience. And it was a little bit, it would have been a little easier. Guys, in December of 2020, I got released from prison. That was about 2 years ago. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans and purpose I have for you, declares the Lord, a future and a hope." Guys, that's so true. That's one of my favorite verses. I don't know if I told you this. I don't remember on my notes, but an old timer told me when I first went into prison to forget about my family and friends. They wouldn't be there. Well, guys, he did to give me some helpful information. But this is 14 years later, folks. I get released from prison. It's during the COVID. You talk about y'all was all locked down. We was really locked down in prison. So when them front doors opened, man, I was ready to run. But do y'all know what the first thing I seen when I opened that door? I seen those two blonde-headed boys out there in that car. That's an answer to prayer. My sister and my mom. That's a miracle right there. And Michelle kept my boys in my life and would bring them to visit me. And they took me to the halfway house. I hadn't talked to this guy in over 10 years. I was talking to Cody Wolf. And he told me about a job that Shannon Bassett had putting casino chairs together. I talked to my brother, asked him if he knew anything about it. Next thing you know, I was talking to Shannon about my job. She hired me on the spot, folks. God was already planning my comeback before I ever stepped foot from prison. I had a job because that's where a lot of people, you know, the deck's stacked against you when you've been in prison. But I had the family support, I had God, and I got that job right off the flip. I didn't know what I was getting myself into when I said yes to her and I'd take that job, because I know many people in here work cattle and the cattle will test your faith. I'm here to tell you that those casino chairs will test you too. Well, there's some of my work family back here. The first week I had that job, folks, I had Band-Aids on my every hand, you know. But I'm very thankful for my job. It's a good place to work. It's like our own little family up there. I have different ones helping me at a new job. I'm so blessed. I'm surrounded by caring people up there. That's where I needed to be. I didn't need to go into a hostile environment just first getting out of prison. I needed that care and the family support, and I got that up there where I work. And I'm very thankful for my job and the people I work with. Guys, I just had a shoulder surgery about 3 months ago, and I've been on light duty. And this is another humbling experience, because I'm wanting to get in there and do my part. And these people have had to carry my weight, and I'm so thankful for that. And another thing about my shoulders, whenever Dennis had the prayer or the service up here, when him and Jess laid hands on me that day, I'm telling you, there was heat come through my shoulder. And I've not had no more pain since that day. So God, he heals too. I'm telling you, that happened in my life. Guys, God has brought restoration in my family and my friends. He's healed my mind. I've been clean for 16 years. That's a miracle. In my old age, I've even won a few ropings. Thanks to Kel, he's let me borrow a horse or two. God has changed my life from a total failure to a productive citizen. From a stony heart that we read about to an obedient heart. And folks, he can do the same in your life or someone you're praying for. Maybe you're praying for somebody. My mom, many of you all prayed for me many years, and it took a lot. But I'm here to stand before you that God answered y'all's prayers. In closing, maybe you have a stony heart and you're at the end of your rope or struggling with an addiction or anything. Folks, nothing changes if nothing changes. I have four simple truths, four little nuggets that changed my life in prison. I'd heard them all my life, and many of y'all talked about them. Number one is desire. Folks, you got to have a desire to change. If you don't have a desire to change, you'll never change. I know when I was using drugs all the time, I felt like I deserved that life. That was a lie. I was deceived from the enemy. But if you'll have a desire, and my scripture is Psalms 37, 4 and 5. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you your heart's desires. Commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust Him, and He will help you. Guys, that's key. Trust in God. And having a new desire, that's the start. Number two, is ask. You got to ask Jesus to help you. You got to invite Him on the scene. If you will invite Jesus on the scene, He can change any situation. But you got to humble yourself and ask Him. Invite His presence, because He has the power to transform your life. Number three, Dennis talked about this the other day, is just have a little bit of faith. Mustard seed faith. It says, Luke 17:6, the Lord answered, if you had faith, even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, you may be uprooted and be planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Dennis gave a very good demonstration with Mr. Todd Blocker the other day about a mustard seed, and he done an excellent job. Done a lot better than I would have. That was, how big is a piece of mustard seed? Just a little bitty piece. Guys, if you'll have just a little bit of faith, I'm telling you, your situation can change. My favorite part is believe. That's point number four. Number one was desire. Number two was ask. Number three was have a little faith. And the last one, if you will believe, there's something better. Then Jesus, that's Mark 11:22. Then Jesus said to the disciples, have faith in God. I tell you the truth. You can say to this mountain, may you be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and it will be happen. But you must really believe it will happen and have no doubt in your heart. Verse 24. All right. I tell you, you can pray for anything, and if you believe that you received, it will be yours. Verse 25, but when you are praying, first forgive anyone you are holding a grudge against, so that your Father in heaven will forgive your sins. Both of those scriptures, there's something very key in there that I want to leave you with this. If you'll speak directly to your mountain, both of those verses talk about speaking to the mulberry tree or speaking to your mountain. Folks, speak directly to your mountain about how big your God is. Don't go around talking about, I have this, I have that. Talk to that mountain about how big your God is. And I'm here to tell you, God can change anything. Because remember, all things are possible with God. Amen. I'm going to turn this service over to one of my heroes of faith, Mr. Dennis Delosier. Thank you. Thank you. It's about God.
Thank you, Todd, very much. Well, that's going to be hard to follow. I want everybody to say, hallelujah, I've been to church today. Amen. And the reason you've been in church today is because there's been an anointing here. And that anointing comes, how many times during his presentation did you hear the word heart mentioned? Everybody say several. I didn't count them, but several. It's a heart issue. And, oh me, I looked up a definition of anointing last night, and it's a movement from someone's heart to another person's heart. And you felt that today. And if you haven't felt that in the Holy Spirit, where it's moved in your heart and your soul and body, where you have had a transformation and been saved from all your sins, you have heard a sermon today on witnessing. Don't leave here in a situation in your own heart where you're not in right standing with God and righteousness has not been felt in your Holy Spirit, because the opportunity is here that you turn it all over to Him to be witnessed, to be a witness. You can't be a witness until you are first saved. Over the last 5 weeks, Michelle has spoke on goals. We had Izzy speak on Holy Spirit. Jess spoke on the church. I spoke on faith to you. Put all those together. I felt like a giant locomotive. Just get cranked up and going. Be challenged. Get out there and get the Holy Spirit moving in your life and that anointing moving from one person to the other. But the situation here is like Todd said. It can't move until it comes from Him to somebody else, but you got to be right before it can happen. So that opportunity is here today. Don't leave here without taking advantage of it. Jess and James here, Rita, Kenny, Melinda back there, Larry, any of you that need to talk to anyone on your salvation, do so. If you need healing upon your body for anything from the top of your head to the tips of your toes to the sole of your feet, it's available, right, Larry? It's here. All you've got to do is speak to it, and it's going to happen. It's like Todd witnessed to you this morning. He is a witness, yeah, big time. I mean, it's present. So we will close. You are moved to come forward after church, and we'll embarrass anybody, but please, don't leave here without accepting the Lord Jesus as your Savior. One announcement, Mr. Blocker and his FFA students will be here next week. Everybody give Mr. Blocker a hand, because he's going to get them all. We'll end on a high note. We've got Pastor Bruce coming next week, Bruce Butler. If any of you don't know Bruce Butler, man, you better be here. Men's breakfast, thank you, on Saturday morning. And Todd, we do appreciate you very much. And we appreciate your folks. We wish them speedy, just get healthy this week. And it's been kind of a trying week on the ranch, right? There's a man over here shaking his head, he knows. But it's going to get better. Things are getting better, and we're building, cranking up. Heavenly Father, we just love you so much. Just stand, please, and we'll close, and you can be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we just love you so much. We take this as a serious situation that we